Our six guests tonight thought they had this battle won. Quebec was onside, and so were they. Well, how do they feel about Canada's future after two major constitutional failures? How do they feel as Quebec once again heads towards the brink, dragging the rest of Canada kicking and screaming? Let us introduce them to you as they do at First Ministers' conferences in the order in which their provinces entered Confederation. David Peterson was Premier of Ontario from 1985 to 1990. He now practices law and is helping to start Canada's first National Basketball Association team. John Buchanan was Premier of Nova Scotia from 1978 to 88. He is now a Conservative Senator in Ottawa. Howard Pauley was Premier of Manitoba from 1981 to 88. He now teaches political science at the University of Windsor. Joe Giz was Premier of Prince Edward Island from 1986 to 93. He is now the Dean of Law at Dalhousie University. Grant Devine was Saskatchewan Premier from 1982 to 91. He'd like to get that job back. He's leader of the opposition in Saskatchewan today. And Brian Peckford was Premier of Newfoundland from 1979 to 1989. He now runs his own consulting business in British Columbia. Welcome, one and all. We are very grateful that you could come from points near and far to be with us tonight. We're on your home turf. Let me start with you. I was talking to a friend of yours the other day.
I still have some, you mean.
You do indeed. He was saying, I've known David Peterson a long time. I've never seen him so down about the future of the country. I've never seen him so pessimistic, so absent of hope about the future of Canada. Did he accurately characterize your feelings?
I think it's grim. I think it's salvageable, but I think it's grim. And I looked at that tape, and I thought that tape was extremely well done, Stephen, and it was quite depressing. That little girl who says, I hope it never happens, but I think it is going to happen. There's no charity left. There's no passion left for the country. This is a totally different scene than the referendum of 1980. People are saying, oh, to hell with them. I've put up with enough. Let them go. Stop the whining. There's no energy. There's no passion. There's no commitment back to the country. I don't see those palpable expressions of love for country that we saw before. I don't want to be overly dramatic, but it is my view that when history is written, it will be seen that the death of Meech Lake, not Charlottetown, because Charlottetown was really a symptom of Meech, was the end of tolerance. That's, everybody here gave an awful lot. It was very, very, very hard. It wasn't popular at home. We all knew it. We felt we were doing the best thing. Everybody's working hard to see the other guy's point of view. Now, nobody does that anymore.
Senator,
there is just, it's all fiefdoms, and even Ontario's behaving like a regional whining fiefdom.
More on that to come. You agree with Premier Peterson's view that things appear to be as bleak now as they've ever been?
First of all, Steve, just a correction.
Yes,
I'd like to correct TV commentators. I was Premier of Nova Scotia from 78 until 1990.
Oh, my goodness, I shortchanged you a couple of years. Congratulations.
Nobody remembers that long ago, John.
I do. And I do agree, for the most part, with what David said. You know, I think the group of us, Brian Peckford and I go back a little further than the others. We go back, I go back to the first conferences of 78 and leading up to the 1981 Patriation Agreement, as does Brian from 79 to 81. And I remember that, and I remember the problems vis-a-vis Quebec and René Lévesque and his group at that time and not signing the constitutional agreement, and then bring it forward to 1986 when Robert Bourassa brought us in Edmonton, I believe, the five requests he had, and we all were very pleased because it looked like we were going to settle this, and in 87 when we initialed the agreement, and then leading up to 1990 when it failed. And as I look back, I believe that if it had been successful, we would not be in the kind of situation we're in today. So I do agree with David that over the last number of years, as we've taken a look at the political and constitutional scene in Canada, it has deteriorated and has to have deteriorated when you look at what's going on in Ottawa today with the leader of the opposition being a separatist.
Premier Pauley, less optimistic about the future today?
Less optimistic, unfortunately. I think we are reaching the crossroads. The next 2 years are going to be very pivotal, Steve. I don't see any further opportunity to renew the federal system through constitutional process. So I think it's a question of either proceeding with the status quo making administrative arrangements that are acceptable. Or on the other hand, Quebec moving in the direction of sovereignty. It's going to be one or the other. And I suspect that the next 2 years will really be pivotal to that. In fact, probably this year, the upcoming provincial election in Quebec is going to really tell the tale. Although Parizeau can certainly win this year and lose the referendum. In fact, I suspect that could very well occur. So the crossroads, we're at that. And within 2 years, we'll know whether it is a continuance of the status quo or a totally rearranged situation in Canada.
Do you find it amazing that here we are, we're not that far away from a Quebec election and potential referendum. We're not allowed to talk about the Constitution these days. You heard not a word about it in the last federal election. It's the C word. You can't talk about it. And yet everybody seems to be, certainly this side of the House, says that we're in more trouble today than they can recall. Why?
Well,
what gives?
I think we can talk about the Constitution. I think what you're seeing is that the politicians aren't talking about the Constitution because of the two failed attempts in the 1990 and the 1992. This business that's going on in the country today is very much about the Constitution. And it's very much about where we're going to be in Canada in the next 4 or 5 years. While I share the reasons for the pessimism of my former colleagues, I remain an optimist. And I believe that this country's going to survive. I believe that we have one of the finest countries on the face of the earth. And I believe that when the people of Quebec come to make that hard choice, that final act, are we going to go it alone and sever the ties with the country that we've been associated with now for so long, I happen to believe in my heart, and I have no empirical evidence, I speak from my heart, that the people of Quebec will say yes to Canada. And if I didn't believe that today, then I don't think that I could carry on as a Canadian. I think I would be down, I would be depressed, I would know that we in the East are going to be hurt to a far greater extent than any other part of the country because we are so dependent on the generosity and the tolerance and the compassion of people in the rest of the country. So I'm an optimist, and I'm putting my bets for Canada.
I'm going to make a guess, Grant Devine, that since the last election in Saskatchewan, you've done hundreds of interviews and probably never been asked a question about the Constitution. Would I lose that bet or would I win it?
You'd probably win the bet.
What does that say to you?
I think it says what you've heard here, that people, as Joe said, have given up a little bit about a constitutional solution or reconciliation. They're really worried about the economy and about jobs and a combination of things. And they feel so far removed about a constitutional solution that it's very frustrating for them, as you saw in the film, to even begin to get their hands on it. One of the things that Joe reminded me of, and here sitting beside my former colleague from Newfoundland, is that what the Meech Lake Accord was about was not about Quebec. It was about Canada. And I remember I was invited to speak in the Newfoundland legislature just prior to the Meech Lake Accord going down. And we can all do this. But I said, it's about my province of Saskatchewan. Okay? It's going to affect how we live in Canada. It's not about Quebec. And, you know, it's come to pass, and everybody said that. And secondly, it's what I noticed, and David raised it, is that there were serious sacrifices, political sacrifices made to reach out for your own province. It didn't look like you were reaching out for your province, but you reached out. And David, you reached, as did a lot of people. But
he's the expert on that.
I mean,
I think, right?
It costs. And I'm not so sure that that all politicians at all times are prepared to pay that price. But there seemed to be a magic at that time that people would reach and say, I'll go for it, at least for, I think, the majority of the people at the table.
But you're a few years away from the next election in Saskatchewan,
though,
right?
It was difficult.
Is there going to be any talk about this in the next election in Saskatchewan?
Well, it might follow the election in Quebec, so we'll see. But it's not on the agenda. I mean, people are just don't know how to deal with it. So they just say, well, as the student said, well, I don't really understand what we do. I suppose they're going to go, and if they go, we'll cope with it. And if they don't, I'm sort of tired of trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
And the problem with that is that you end up with a country that's going to operate a lot differently than it could have, as John pointed out. I mean, if we, and maybe Howard, if we'd have done this, You wouldn't have had a bloc as official opposition in Ottawa today. It wouldn't be there. You wouldn't have had now the big worry all over again. We would have been focused on value-added jobs, new science, new technology, sports, recreation, the environment, all the things that people really want to talk about. But we're back talking about the Constitution because it won't go away because we didn't fix it. So
let me get your, you have a unique perspective here, I would suggest, because you've gone from sea to sea.
Yeah.
You started out in the Atlantic, you're now living on the West Coast, right near Vancouver Island.
Yeah,
what's your read on this?
I follow somewhere, what I lament most is I share a lot of the feelings that David expressed, as well as John and Howard. But I got a sneaky suspicion that what will happen is almost perhaps even worse scenario than what has been painted as being dismal, and that is that we will elect, or Quebec will elect, the Parti Québécois in the fall, and they will move towards putting in place the mechanisms for separation. Mm-hmm. And then later will come a referendum, and the referendum will be defeated, and we'll still be in this constitutional schizophrenic situation that we're in. We don't know where we are, where we're going, or hardly who we are. And I think that's perhaps the worst of all possible worlds. I like things more cleanly cut. You know, that's my personality. That's mm-hmm. where I come from. I like it better packaged than that. And
I mean, you don't like subtle stuff.
I like it straight out. I mean, I don't like this business. Well, subtle is one thing, but going down the tube is another. And excelling in mediocrity is not what excites me. And I got a sneaky suspicion that Canada, unfortunately, is going to find itself in that kind of mediocre, ongoing dispute between ourselves, which gets us nowhere and finds us at the bottom heap of the industrialized countries where I don't like to be.
But
that's
Brian,
what I
Brian,
think.
Brian, on
is
that
like
point, that. Though, I mean, it's an interesting point you raise. What you're saying is you would like to see a definitive solution. But let me just give you an alternative. I would argue there is no definitive solution, never will be.
I agree.
And never
that.
Has been throughout history.
Well, that's what
we've
I'm
been
saying.
Dealing this with for 200 years. And if they go, if Quebec leaves, there will be no definitive solution because we share geography and history and trade and all that. And if they stay,
to be
I guess.
To be mediocre.
What worries me, well, I mean, it's like a marriage. If your dispute solving mechanism works and things come up, you can solve your problems. When you lose the will to use your mechanism to solve your problems, then the marriage collapses.
Right.
And it seems to me, my worry is we're closer to that point of even trying to solve our disputes. I think those that look for perfection in the relationship, i.e. no disputes or
right.
no separatists, are just naive. They're right. always going to be there. They've, in a sense, have always been
oh,
there.
Oh, yeah.
I think it can be a dynamic, constructive tension rather than looking for the ultimate solution.
No, I agree there's always going to be problems. I'm not saying that, but I don't think they have to take on the seriousness of being in the circumstance where you have a highly educated population according to world standards, where we all within Canada and outside revel that this is one of the better places in the world to live, and at the same time we have these 10 units, one of which is one-third of the country, that cannot buy into a constitutional arrangement. And it seems to me that's, you know, extremely ironic. And with all of the potential that we have as a people and as a geography piece on the planet, we're not able to move to the, you know, we're playing the piano with one hand. We can't seem to get the real tune to move into to become a great civilization or a great society. And that's what I lament, that we're going to always have our disputes. We should have it, because I agree in dynamic tension, but I don't agree in it to the extent to which we have
okay, can I comment on that,
Senator?
See, I think that Brian is right and David's right. I think we're
well,
always
we disagree for God's sake, John. Which one
no,
of us is right?
I'm saying that I think, regardless of what happens, we're going to have disputes in this country. I think we all agree with that. I'm also of the opinion that if on the 23rd of June 1990, Manitoba and Newfoundland had ratified the Meech Lake Accord, I'm not one to say that we would not have constitutional problems today. We would have. But the constitutional problems would be nothing as compared to what we do have today. I think
precisely.
The Meech Lake Accord
exactly.
would have
the
settled
issue would
the
be a different level of issue.
That's exactly
an
right, Brian.
Issue instead of a,
yep.
of a founding people issue,
yep.
which gets so fundamental
yep.
and emotive. Whereas if it's mm-hmm. an institutional issue as it relates to the Senate being elected mm-hmm. or remaining in its present form, you know, you can deal with that. That's in a different realm of debate
what
as it relates to country future.
What we would have been able to do is have cleared, I think, the Quebec issue for at least 10 to 15 years.
That's all.
And then we would, yeah, it would not have been much longer than that before.
Really?
I think there would have been further issues, further needs to be resolved. There's flux. But the important thing is we would have been able then to have moved on to other, yes, economic, environmental, all sorts of other issues, but also other constitutional issues. Because we had committed ourselves around that table in 1987 to deal with the fisheries issue, deal with the Senate issue, and most importantly, the Aboriginal issue.
Because it was the Aboriginal issue
that brought it down. I can recall when we signed, I guess I was, my colleagues remember, probably the most reluctant person. I should have held out. But I had particular worries because of the Manitoba political situation, which is very volatile when we deal with constitutional matters. I was certainly greeted upon my return with Elijah Harper advising me privately that he couldn't vote for it. That was certainly a forerunner of what was to come.
He was in your caucus at the time, right?
Yeah, and cabinet minister. And other cabinet ministers were not happy, especially those of Francophone background. Mm-hmm. Felt they had not been properly protected in what we'd agreed to. But most importantly, Sharon Carstairs. Sharon Carstairs was lonely liberal in the legislature. Mm-hmm. Liberals had been very lonely in Manitoba, David, in those years. Sharon rose to great heights. She rose to great heights, and I give her credit, disagreed profoundly with her, but she was seen by Manitobans as representing the Manitoba interest against Quebec, even though it meant that she took on not just the prime minister, but the leader of her own party.
She took all the wackos supporting her, rather, they generally belong in the Tory party, and she got them into the Liberal party for a brief period of time.
Where do we live?
And so she got all this sort of anti-French stuff going.
No, I tell you why she was so wise. She was at Nova Scotia, you knew that.
Oh. Yes.
let's just get back to the larger issue as it relates to the future of the country. I mean, this is what really preoccupies my mind these days, because like being in business that I am now, and now also witnessing the sentiment of the West vis-a-vis the sentiment of the Atlantic provinces and seeing the differences. But everywhere I go these days in the business community, everybody is lamenting the fact that we have this great capacity to excel in so many areas of economic growth.
But not this.
But that we're not going to succeed on the economic front. And essentially, we're not going to succeed because we're so divisive at the present moment as it relates to the political arrangements that are evolving. Because they're all linked. You can't separate one from the other. And that's my great lament, that we'll just continue to row our boat in very rough waters and really not enter the port of great success that we have the potential to do. And I think the whole Meech Lake Accord experience has caused this diversion to becoming the greater society.
Let me try this. We've got a good sampling here tonight of English-Canadian political leadership over the last decade. Can you tell us whether or not English Canada cares anymore about whether Quebec stays or goes? Do they care in Saskatchewan anymore?
As David pointed out, that the capacity for goodwill and for reaching out is changed remarkably compared to what it was. People are frankly more selfish. Now they may have begun to come to the conclusion that this hurts maybe our interest rates, our stability, maybe some other things about the economy. And as Brian says, maybe we're going to end up spending too much time on constitutional things and not be nearly as good as we could be. But it's going to take a while for all of that to soak in. But the capacity for reaching out is not there yet. You couldn't even begin to do a constitutional discussion.
No,
see,
you can't.
In 87 times were buoyant. The economy was moving along quite nicely.
Right.
People were generally fairly content with the direction of job creation, all the other various economic indicators. By about 90, I think the mood had soured. The recession was setting in. It really hasn't gone away yet. Great deal of uncertainty, especially now with the volatility of the market. I think that if we could regain better control of the economy, and there could be some rebounding in the economy, I think that it would be greater generosity or greater preparedness to,
well, yeah,
to
but
deal with
Canadian
the,
people didn't
some
kill
of these
it
issues.
In 1990, and Clyde Wells killed it in 1990 with a little help from
Elijah
from
Harper,
others.
A little help.
Well, I would argue that really, having been there and having watched the dynamic through that very difficult three-week period after the meeting, had Newfoundland been there, you could have fixed the Manitoba
situation.
But the
situation, public opinion polls were very much against Meech by 1980.
But Howard, they turned against. Right. Let me make a point that's important. They Meech, when it was first created, they were not against. 178. And Quebec's behavior with 178 and the notwithstanding clause turned public opinion
this
against
is remind people the inside
170,
outside sign law
178 had nothing to do with Meech Lake, but it had everything to do with Meech Lake in terms of the public opinion. That's what changed public opinion. You track the opinion through that period. And that became so much more difficult for us because, good God, we're not stupid. We're all sitting there knowing what we were doing was not particularly popular, but knowing at the same time the price of failure, at least we felt, I think, the price of failure was so severe that we had to succeed. And that's why we cobbled together this deal in 1990 and the Senate seat from Ontario. That was just to save Clyde's face, to bring him into the net. And then we went through that very difficult period for the three weeks when he cut bait. That was the saddest
day
of my
whole well,
political
David,
life, John.
Because you had suggested that you would give up Senate seats, and then you suggested that
you.
I
yeah,
would
yeah,
and
you.
That Frank McKenna would.
Yeah.
And
you're a good
being
guy.
As charitable as we were, we agreed with you.
Yeah. Did he ask and you I, before? He asked you to give them up?
Oh, he suggested it.
He suggested
but he didn't say
so
it.
So he didn't announce it before passing it by you.
But I look back on that now, and I wouldn't be where I am today.
But if I want to come back to the point, Steve.
Steve, you gave yourself a seat.
Joe Gisbert.
Because I just can't let it go, and that is you asked whether or not Canadians outside of Quebec want the country to stay together, want Quebec to stay in the country. I believe that they do. I do not believe, however, that Canadians have the stomach today for a constitutional
You're
debate.
Right.
But I think if you put it to Canadians, whether they want Quebec to stay, the overwhelming majority would have to be yes.
Of course.
If the overwhelming majority is no, then the game is over anyway.
Well, what if the question is at what price? No, the price before was distinct society, and a lot of people weren't prepared to pay that price.
Well, yeah. I think that at that time, I mean, the distinct society, and I guess this is partially our fault was really never understood to the extent that it could have been. The distinct society was not going to change Canada one iota, in my view.
Robert Bourassa was sure saying it would.
Well, we had the top constitutional experts in the room at the Langevin building at that all-night session. In 1987, we had Frank Iacobucci, we had Peter Hogg, and we had some others. And all of the constitutional experts that we had there at two and three times in during that evening and night, long night, told us that there would be no additional transfer of powers to Quebec except, and this was Peter Hogg's opinion only on the margins of the Constitution.
That's right.
So Quebec was not getting anything really substantial.
Nobody believed it.
It was getting...
People did not believe it.
People did not believe
it. Can I
agree with that, but let's put that important point in perspective.
Right, I agree with that, but I think something else has to be brought into the discussion, and it's this, and it goes right back to, and right up. Back in the patriation days...
82.
In 1982, when the... we brought the Constitution home, if you want, and did some would classify as minor amendments, other would classify as major amendments.
Should we establish that? You were there?
Senator Buchanan was there, yeah.
Scene, yep.
Okay, when we had our own constitution, as some people would like to allege the way the thing operates. Mm-hmm. But I think something happened during that period of time, because if you remember, there was some substantial disagreement among the provinces and the way the federal government was operating to bring the Constitution home or to patriate the Constitution. And it broke out into Ontario and New Brunswick and the federal government being on one side, and then the Gang of Eight, if you will, or the other eight provinces being on the other side. And what came out, and this is significant in my view historically and where we are now, and which has led to a lot of suspicion about the cynicism about politics and government in Canada. There were some secret documents that were released. There were some secret meetings that were held. There were all kinds of secret meetings. And I think you can go back and trace some of the cynicism and the lack of transparency to some of the events that occurred at that time, which repeated themselves throughout the constitutional discussions. to the point where I can almost, with not stretching my imagination too much, bring it right up to the day where I know there are Canadians in this country that are saying, how come Montreal can get that environment center for NAFTA? There was no due process used. It wasn't transparent. There was no accountability like was promised. We weren't going to go back to the way things were done in the past. And I would use as the watershed that whole patriation period where a lot of people started to get suspicious about politicians doing things in secret when it was part of our responsibility.
Now, Brian, that's not fair.
And I think
that's not fair, Brian. That's not fair. That NAFTA thing is a symptom. That NAFTA
sure
thing, you're using that in a pejorative way.
No.
That a lot of the opposition parties in this Canada want and people that want to drive
just
a wedge
that as an example.
Between English Canada and French Canada. You're talking of a NAFTA center of 30 jobs. We're seeing
it's
the most
symbolic.
Petty. We're seeing a petty
but
discussion.
Joe, let me just bring you to another example.
Over 30 jobs.
It's
come on, Brian. Are we
nothing.
Down
Joe,
to 30
no,
jobs?
No, it's Joe. Got nothing to do with the NAFTA Center. It's got to do with the business of accountability, of due process.
Oh, come on,
it's
Brian.
Like,
it's
yes,
got
it has,
a minor political decision. 30 jobs is peanuts in
no,
the grand scheme of things.
No, I'm not talking about the 30 jobs.
The people that want to drive wedges are doing it. What bothers me.
I'm talking about a process of decision making.
What bothers me is we've become more regional fiefdoms now, whining about everything. There's no sense of the center, no sense anywhere of the nationalism, no sense of sacrifice. I mean, good God, if you're going to whine about 30 jobs
let me go back to 87 because I know something about
you,
the FAD. And I wasn't whining in 87. I was maybe whining, I think, properly in 86. But I tell you, the province hadn't forgiven by 87. That
remind,
was the CF18 decision.
Let's remind people what it's all about.
The,
it was a choice between...
87 was, 86 was a decision
totally
to
situation.
Award the CF18 contract to Canadair rather than Bristol Aero
Canada
in Winnipeg,
and
even though Bristol Aero had the best contract, lowest bid, the best quality product, created tremendous... I've never seen such political temperature over an issue as occurred in the fall of 1986. And in fact, that issue is still remembered with great abhorrence in Manitoba. It wasn't just a question of 30, 35 jobs, Joe, as the NAFTA one is, but it was something
that was
about
a big one.
the clout of small provinces within the political system and what was seen to be an unfair decision by a federal government awarding this contract to Quebec for political reasons.
But don't you think it's sad that we're sitting back in our own fiefdoms in Canada with a checklist and saying, well, Quebec got that, Ontario got that, now it's Saskatchewan.
It's a reality.
Happening.
But, Joe,
it's
a reality of these regional tensions.
Granted,
you can't ignore them. They're there.
I think, as John would say, you're all right. And I can give you an example. In Saskatchewan, we were the first province to pass the Meech Lake Accord after Quebec.
Right.
And Alan Blakeney supported it, Liberals supported it, and we supported it. It was virtually unanimous.
You didn't have opposition. In Saskatchewan?
No, it was there. Yeah. It passed. And Alan Blakeney was in there in 82. It was there in 82 in terms of a person who brought the Constitution home.
Yep.
The goodwill in Saskatchewan was evident and it was nonpartisan. Now, what I think you're seeing, and Brian raises the point, is that as we've failed in this, the goodwill has gone down and you're into a different league, Joe. You're into where, I mean, I would say that people will watch federal elections or provincial elections in Quebec and they say, well, we'll have to ante up to keep them in and ante up and then, you know, back and forth. And it gets, people are very skeptical about that. They don't like it and it feeds on sort of the selfishness of the regions.
Yep.
And they say, you watch the election in Quebec coming up and you watch the federal government. I'm not blaming any political party.
Well,
it's just, it's the way it is. And they're going to look like a little bit of bribery, a little bit of blackmail,
time.
A little bit of this, a little bit of that. And the country's going to spend more time on that nonsense than it needs to be or should have.
Look, Grant, the GST Processing Center for all of Canada is being built in Summerside, Prince Edward Island. That's a $40 million construction project. There will be somewhere between 600 and 1,000 good jobs. I didn't hear a peep. In the rest of the country.
Absolutely.
That's true.
Absolutely.
Not a peep.
That's
look,
true.
Look, 30 jobs in Quebec
because
and
that's
people
right.
get
tired. Exactly. Oh, no,
exactly.
But no, you're not talking about the same thing, Joe.
Yeah.
It was, there was, when a country, when you see a small province like PEI and lose its military establishment, that it had in Summerside PEI, which became a national issue, Canadians have the will and the broad-mindedness to say that if we're deciding upon some national this office like that, that this is a good trade-off. And that's quite acceptable. However, when you have 24 places in the country that have been told that they are part of a process which will be adjudicated independently for something, regardless of how many jobs it is very symbolic, then you're into a different circumstance altogether. Okay. And my point is simply that the Canadian people have moved to a point where they're so cynical that they want to see transparency and due process in a lot of activities that hitherto were done under the old British parliamentary system, which no longer is operative.
Following your comments then of a few moments ago, let me take you all back to 1987 to figure out why we are where we are today.
Can I make a comment on that?
Because I knew you weren't going to let me get through this speech. Go ahead, Senator.
I just want to comment on 1987. You see, there's something very fundamental that we missed in 1980, 81, 82. And that is, on looking back, hindsight's a great thing. And on looking back, I can't for the life of me understand why we allowed that 3-year period to exist in the 1982 or 81 accord. Quite frankly, I'll admit one thing, I plead ignorance of it. I don't remember that it was really there.
Let me just explain to viewers what you're talking about. Signed the Meech Lake Accord in 87.
Yes.
That started a 3-year clock.
That, 87.
Within which,
that started
within
a 3-year
which
clock.
All the legislatures of the land had to pass the Meech Lake Accord.
But it's a strange thing, Steve, that there are a lot of people in this country, a lot of political people, who didn't know that that 3-year period came about not as a result of the Meech Lake Accord. It came about as a result of the 1982 Accord, and I was there and Brian was there.
Could you not have changed it? What was the 3-year?
Yes, it could have been changed, and that's why I say that maybe the fundamental flaw in 87 was we didn't change.
If it had been six months, Meech Lake would be the law of the land
today. Yeah, Meech Lake would have gone through
one of the things, and we were dealing with a whole bunch of things we were handed. We didn't invent the deck.
Newfoundland even passed it, and then it was reneged in 3 years.
Exactly. Steve, is that
6 months wouldn't have done it.
You did put it through, though, right?
Yes,
you put it through the Newfoundland House of Assembly.
Newfoundland legislature passed by both parties.
Right. Mm-hmm. Then Clyde Wells becomes premier.
The whole thing starts. He wins the election, and then he says, "I'm opposed to this," and then goes in the legislature, introduces a bill to renege upon the
Manitoba never passed it. Why didn't Manitoba pass it?
I think we could have done it in a year's time because it was 3 years. It was not a matter of priority. Certainly, we didn't rush out into hearings upon our return. Nor did the opposition want to go into hearings at that particular point. We decided we were going to go by the next winter. Of course, our government fell.
Did you think you'd lose the election if you pushed it through in as brief a period of time after
Meech Lake? Oh, yes. Manitoba was very, very conscious of process. And this goes back to 87, the reluctance on my part, because I knew better than my colleagues here. I had been burned severely in the French language debate in 1983-84.
Yeah, I remember.
And we had tried to proceed with constitutional changes without hearings, without due process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we created a storm in the province. It was written into our laws that in the event that there was going to be any further constitutional changes, there had to be public hearings, and those hearings were not to be a rubber stamp kind of approach. So we needed at least a year to have dealt with it in Manitoba.
Everybody championed. And I remember doing scrums with you at Queen's Park at the time about this. Everybody championed the unanimity of this. And this is a unanimous agreement. I think, who was it? Bourassa, who said we can't change a comma.
We can't
even change a comma on it. You guys have all agreed to it, and that's it.
That's
how
right.
Come?
First of all, we changed a whole bunch in the final deal. But what you have to, Stephen, one of the things we're missing in this discussion, and you pointed out earlier, you're talking to six English language former premiers. There's two sets of messages were coming through this entire debate, one in Quebec and one here. Mm-hmm. And we're not, to have a complete debate, we've got to understand how the things we talk about, the things we believe in, are being received there.
We should say Bourassa is out of the country.
Well,
we invited him.
But let me just say, in this whole Meech Lake debate, it was the symbolism was totally different. In English Canada, it became a special deal for Quebec, some kind of special status. They got so English Canadians were saying, I'm not going to let some Quebecer get ahead of me on the deal, not understanding what was in it. On the other hand, the Quebecer was looking at this thing saying,
And by the way, nobody knew what was in Meech Lake, even though it was a very simple document. The Quebecer on the streets of Chicoutimi would say, "You like me, you like Meech Lake." It's an affirmation of my dignity.
That's it.
The French word is appartenance. It was belonging.
It was saying
the whole debate was about dignity and very little about law.
Exactly.
In fact,
well said,
what happened was we lost that opportunity. And now it goes back to a point Grant was making earlier. There's no charity left. We can't generate it anymore.
And that's why I'm saying, though, David, that take that one step further. There is in the country this desire, almost demand, that if our politicians do anything these days, it's got to be even the smallest little issue. And you see it in British Columbia, you see it in Newfoundland. You've got to go through a due process where it's not only perceived that
Charlottetown was processed to death and ended up with a bloody dog's breakfast that the Canadians rejected. And it wasn't like they weren't consulted.
And David, I think it was the Charter of Rights and Freedoms that changed much of that, because up until 82, certainly the Constitution was a government document. Mm-hmm. But with the Charter of Rights, we bring many other charter groups into the Constitution, the multicultural community, the Aboriginal community, and others.
Yes, well, you had more
maybe
access
to
debate.
Maybe we didn't recognize as adequately as we might have in 87 that the game had changed, that they were no longer spectators but actually participants outside of governments in the process.
Chris Howard, you may recall that the 82 document was not even ratified by a legislature. It was signed by the premiers who were there, Les Rennie Levesque, and the prime minister.
You know,
I didn't put it in my legislature because there was no need to do it at the time.
No one cared, right?
But John,
the process for ratification was, I think, put in the 82.
Yes, that's
what we were committed to by 87.
We were committed to it by 87.
I want to raise a point.
The unanimity was created in 82. We didn't create unanimity.
That's right.
I want to raise the point of that
Brian
we're all
and
responsible
I are to blame for
the failure, Steve.
I don't blame you.
You're saying you're all what?
We are all, Canadians are all responsible, collectively responsible for the failure of Meech Lake and subsequent constitutional courts. And I want to include the media, because I've shared with my colleagues here something that happened to me. After we passed the constitutional accord in Saskatchewan, we were the first out of Quebec to do it. Then, as David pointed out, there started to be more and more stories about Quebec and about, you know, what they were getting, what a distinct society was, and so forth, and on and on. And I met and was invited by the managing editors of all the Western, or most of the Western Canadian newspapers, to speak at a luncheon in Saskatoon. And so I was a guest speaker, and I spoke about the Constitution, and then we opened it up for questions. And they drilled me, and it was very, very difficult. And I got frustrated after a while, and something told me that maybe they didn't know what they were talking about. So I looked them in the eye and I said, have any of you read the Meech Lake Accord?
These are the reporters you're
talking
to.
These are managing editors.
Managing editors.
Editorials all the time in the papers against Quebec and all this. Have any of you read the Meech Lake Accord? How many hands do you think went up?
Very few.
Tell me some went up.
None.
Zero.
Zero. And I looked at them, I mean, and then I give them a bit of a tongue lashing, I mean, to say the least.
And it's only a page and a half, tiny little page.
And it lays out. I said, so what are the conditions? And, you know, what does it mean? What does distinct mean? And the language and the culture and the law.
But maybe it was a case that because of the lack of public consultation, we didn't care what was in it.
These are managing editors. These are opinion leaders. They're writing editorials that are starting to kick the living daylights out of something the first ministers were bringing to the people. And they wanted transparency, and they didn't even take the time to read the constitutional accord in talking to a first minister that was there that had passed the legislature. And as I'm sitting here, we will have earned every bit of trouble we're into if that's the attitude of Canadians and of opinion leaders. And it's not just the media, it's all Canadians.
I leave
that with you because that leads to another problem, and it leads to, as Brian said, it was too late in the Charlottetown Accord.
Steve, I just want to comment on that
poisoned,
because
you know?
I was asked back in the latter part of 89 to come to Toronto and speak to a group of people in the business world, bankers, trust company presidents, and to discuss the Meech Lake Accord. And I did the same thing. I asked them how many had read it, and none of them had read it. And there were questions that were asked later indicated clearly to me they hadn't read it.
Right.
And these were some of the leading business people in Canada. And this was just months away from June 23rd, 1990. They didn't know what was in the accord.
Do you have any theories as to why this was? They couldn't take the trouble. They couldn't be bothered. They thought it was too complicated. It was a deal behind closed doors. It's not our deal.
It wasn't complicated.
Steve, let's just move on to where I think referendums played a very effective role. And normally I'm not for referendums. But I had to reluctantly acknowledge that, at least in the Charlottetown Accord, people did read the document. I remember going out to discuss the Charlottetown Accord in a meeting which we expected 50 people, a panel, and 500, the same night the Blue Jays were playing the final series. It was amazing. Everybody was there with a copy of their accord. They had read it.
And it was a lot bigger than Meech.
Might disagree with what they were saying, but unlike Meech, they were reading it.
100 times more.
And looking back, maybe hindsight, maybe we can learn. Without a doubt, if we had gone to a referendum within 6 months, just say we weren't going to have hearings, just going to take it directly to the people. Mm-hmm. By the end of 87, Meech Lake would have carried overwhelmingly throughout the country.
Don't you find it ironic, though, that one of the reasons that Meech Lake couldn't be touched was because we'd never get unanimity on anything this important again? That was the explanation given at the time. And yet, just a few years later, Charlottetown, much more ambitious, much bigger, unanimity again. And maybe the arguments for unanimity.
Unanimity in Charlottetown because the country was facing the certain prospect of a referendum in Quebec by October the 26th, 1992, on sovereignty.
So the gun was to our head.
So the obligation was on all of the provinces to ensure that did not happen. And that's why we got Charlottetown.
Would that happen 2 years from now again if there was another referendum?
It could.
Deal with the Quebec referendum?
It could.
Do you think there's that goodwill out there to make another attempt like
Howard,
that?
If some of the things that you described earlier happen, namely if the economy improves and people are getting back to work and trust is restored again in the political leadership of the country, I think it can happen. Yeah, there's a lot of ifs, but it can happen. And but let's remember that at Charlottetown, the reason it came about then was because of this question of the sovereignty referendum. And the reason the package was so big is because none of the actors would come to the table unless their issue was addressed. The Western premier said, we're not going to discuss it unless Senate reform is discussed. Northerner said, we're not going to discuss it unless the way we enter Confederation is discussed. Ontario said, under the new premier, Premier Ray, that we're not going to the discussion unless the economic and social union is addressed. Right. Easterners said we're not going to discuss it unless equalization is addressed. The Aboriginal leadership of the country rightly said that unless they are included in the process, that they will do their utmost to frustrate it. That's why we had this great package.
So what you had, Joe, is a whole bunch of groups who only cared about their own agenda, bartering their support for the other one, brokering this very messy deal. And
not taking
there was no national vision left, and it was impossible to generate, because what happened? The guys that had the national vision before got clobbered, and so the politicians who are becoming more and more regional, they say, "Gee, I can't be sensitive to Quebec, because if I do, I'll get hammered.
You're right,
I'll have some guy like the mayor of
Sault Ste.
Marie, Joe Fertizzi, running an anti-French campaign." Mm-hmm. And, you know, and the tragedy is it works. At the end of the day, you're only going to have charitable politicians if you have charitable people. Mm-hmm. What's happening, though, the politicians are pandering to the lowest elements, not the highest elements.
Well, let's just bring it to where we're going. I mean, we'll lumber along. I mean, it seems to me that, unfortunately, that is the reality of Canada because of its geography, history, and all the rest of the way things are going.
Well,
it has something to do with leadership as well.
If that is the case, let me hypothesize here for a second, as long as we're blue-skying it a bit. If Meech never came along, if Meech never happened, in other words, the Quebec agenda, and you were able to just go straight to Charlottetown, Senate, Aboriginal issues, Quebec, and all the other things involved too, maybe Charlottetown would have passed, right? If there weren't that
higher probability of passing.
Higher probability of passing.
But you see, one thing that I noticed.
To give you second thoughts about having gone through Meech,
you can't do that. I mean, there's no value.
What happened, and will likely continue to happen because it's a democracy and people are politicians. As I described how the managing editors weren't really for Meech Lake after a while, had not read it. they would be attracted to a politician who was beginning to give them what they wanted to hear about Quebec. So when our friend, the Premier of Newfoundland at that time, would travel across, he became very, across Canada, became very popular, speaking about, well, this is really what the Constitution says, and this is real. And it, because they hadn't read it, and because it was popular, and that, and that's, I mean, that can happen over and over and over again, given the skeptical nature of the public. That's where I think if we don't mature,
exactly,
if we don't mature as a more sophisticated and growing-up democracy, we're going to be fooled, and we're going to suffer. We're going to end up in mediocrity because we go over and over and over again. And that's a growing-up thing. And maybe it will take some time. And
we're stuck in that.
We heard Premier Peterson at the very beginning of the show talk about the blood that was spilled, everybody's blood together on the table. You all put a lot of your political and emotional, I think, probably, capital in the Meech Lake Accord. Question, has any of you spoken to Clyde Wells recently?
I have.
Oh, yeah.
You still talk to him?
Mm. Oh, I guess.
You hate his guts?
No.
You don't hate him?
No.
I like
Clyde.
Life goes on?
Clyde's
have you talked to Clyde Wells?
No.
You haven't talked to him?
I've talked to
him. Do you still feel pretty...
No, I don't hate him. I think he made an error of historical significance. I mean, a huge error, not a little error. A huge, because Clyde Wells believed when he made the decision not to do it, and Grant went down there, and I went down there, Prime Minister went down to speak in Newfoundland. I mean, basically, it was frankly rather humiliating, but I thought, well, I'd genuflect and kiss his backside if that's what he was demanding, in order to, because it was so important to the country to get him in there. But he didn't believe there were any consequences from the failure of Meech Lake. Honestly, and he pushed and say, he honestly believed nothing would happen. It would just be. And all the rest of us, even those that weren't close to it, believed there were going to be serious consequences of failure. We couldn't go around and threaten people. We didn't want to sort of say there's going to be grievous consequences. But we knew there would be, and we knew the price of failure was high. Mm-hmm. Clyde just didn't understand. So people would say, you know, Clyde, what's happening in Quebec? And he would say, no, that's not what I hear in Quebec. That's not my information. Bourassa would be sitting there telling him, good Lord, you know, Clyde, if we don't support this thing, the consequences down the line. He said, no, that's not right.
Well,
that's
it's been 7 years so since you signed Meech Lake. So what have the consequences been?
Lucien Bouchard.
Obvious, Stephen.
Two major regional parties.
Well, some would say, hey, look, we're still kicking along.
So obvious the answer to that question that it's not even an answer. Well, you have the Bloc in Ottawa, you have the regional party in the West, which I would believe is related to this, the Bloc. The Reform Party.
No question.
You have a regionalism in this country. You have never had, never before, even though we've had independent movements in this country before, never at the same time have you had two major regional blocs who basically thrive in the fact they don't have to get along, who have nothing in common,
absolutely,
and have no desire to build anything in common.
And the other thing, the sovereignty movement,
I think the sovereignty movement in Quebec is stronger, and it also is based more on economic rather than the cultural and linguistic concerns, which was the case in 80. And secondly, they openly say it's no longer a question of sovereignty as association. It's a question of sovereignty that's going to be on the ballot.
Separation.
It's no longer a matter of negotiating. The question is going to be, do you favor? So there's been a hardening of the position.
Sure, Stephen, let me put it
hardenings
this,
in Quebec, a hardening in Western Canada.
Let me just put it to you this way. This is since I've been out of politics. In my own consulting business, in 1991 and 1992, I did substantial work in the province of Quebec as a private business consultant. And I spent a lot of time throughout the province of Quebec. And I was absolutely astounded, still am to this very moment, with the reception that I would receive in Chicoutimi and Rimouski, as well as Trois-Rivières, Bromptonville, where I did
because
a lot of work.
Because you signed Meech Lake?
Because I was a Meech Lake supporter. And I would walk into a hotel with two and three business people and sit down to have a dinner to discuss business, just getting off the plane and discuss business. And the number of people that would come over to our table and pat you on the back to say, you're great. And the business people who would say to me, the largest independent businesses, totally indigenous Quebec businesses in metal fabrication and so on in the province of Quebec, who said to me, frankly, they would have great difficulty in the future supporting some kind of a renewed federalism now. and that they were quite likely to be financially supporting the Parti Québécois, which they did.
And there's been a shift since 80 insofar as the business community
is concerned.
You know,
Brian is right, but why is it that nobody in English Canada, unless you've been there, understands that, Brian? How personally it was taken. It was taken
very personal.
In Quebec
very.
As an insulting
It was a repudiation. As far as they were concerned, it was a repudiation of Quebec.
You try to explain that, and people don't understand it, because I guess people take it personally.
And at the same time, here. I mean, the same thing's happened to me in Quebec, and I have daughters that have gone to school in Laval, got your degrees there, and they'll attest to it. While that day I could have left my riding and gone down to Quebec and got the same sort of reception because they recognized your face and you knew they were there, were the first province to pass Meech. The day I left my riding and the day I went back home, people, some of my best supporters, would just lay the wood to me. And absolutely.
This is in Saskatchewan.
Oh, absolutely. Howard, you would understand that.
And you're on their
Just imagine what it was like in Manitoba.
This is true in Quebec today. Yeah. You can walk into Quebec today and the same thing will happen. And I had connections with some of the former cabinet ministers in Mr. Levesque's government, okay, who were out in the consulting business too. And we did some business together, right? Did, you know, raw business together. But the people that they...
What kind of business are you doing?
Well, it was...
raw business.
No, it was you know, the as opposed to politics. Right. You know what I mean? It was just straight
just
business
a joke,
dealings.
Brian. Yeah. Nothing to feed. Don't worry that you're a capitalist now.
No. Give me your card, and then you put you to work.
No.
He
what I'm saying...
He was always a capitalist.
But what I'm saying is that they were able to generate these former cabinet ministers that were in a separatist government in Quebec, were able to generate substantial business and have large consulting business firms in Quebec from businesses in Quebec who hitherto had been strong federalists and who had walked across the Rubicon and now were financial supporters of the Parti Québécois and who felt very comfortable having as a business consultant somebody who was an avowed
separatist. The problem is now that we've moved on. As far as Quebec is concerned with the Charlottetown Accord, not enough was offered to Quebec. As far as the rest of Canada is concerned, too much was offered.
Yes.
So we're caught in that dichotomy.
Yes, you're right.
And that's a bind that we're
out
in.
Out west right now, there is, Grant
Steve,
can speak better than I.
I think the kind of resurgence of the separatist movement, so-called, in Quebec, I think it really started on the 24th of June, 1990. If you look back and you look what happened after that, you see the Parti Québécois getting stronger. You see the emergence of Lucien Bouchard in the Bloc. And something Howard said a few minutes ago, in 1980, there was a separatist government in Quebec, and the referendum was lost. Right. All right? You've got a different equation today. You've got a possible separatist government in Quebec by the time a referendum may be held, but you've also got 54 members of parliament who are the members of Her Majesty's loyal opposition, that's a contradiction in itself, who are in Ottawa, who openly will tell you, and we're paying them, openly tell the people of Canada they're there to break up the country. That's part of the equation that was not present in 1980.
Right.
So you've got two situations, one situation that we didn't have in 1980, and I believe that a lot of this came about as a result of people in Quebec, not all the people, a lot of people in Quebec looked at Meech Lake on the 24th and said, that's a repudiation of Quebec by the rest of Canada.
Okay,
I'm convinced of that.
Given the scenario you've just described, is it possible at this stage of the game for English Canada to put any kind of package together that would satisfy Quebec?
No. Nope.
I believe that
impossible?
It's not possible at this point.
Not this point.
What happens 2 years from now when we reach another crunch is a different story. If the economy's undergone some improvement, if the referendum is moving along in Quebec, it appears it might pass, you might find some element of generosity at that time. Certainly you're not going to discover it in 1994.
What kind of compromises, Premier Giz, would it take to get Quebec on side today? What kind of compromises could English Canada propose?
Well, I think there would have to be a transfer of some powers.
Constitutionally or administratively or what?
Well, constitutionally, ideally, and if not constitutionally, then administratively. But that's really what was the bugbear in Quebec with respect to the Charlottetown Accord, was that Quebec was not receiving the additional powers that it sought as proposed by Jean Allaire when he wrote the Allaire Report. Right. Now, that's going to be a very difficult question for the rest of the country.
It's just not acceptable.
Very difficult. I mean, it's possible, but it's going to be very difficult. In 1987, the devolution of additional power was substituted for the recognition of Quebec as a distinct society.
Right.
I think we've moved beyond that now.
Yeah.
And how the equation is going to eventually sort itself out, I can't answer. But I think the secret lies in powers and talking about asymmetrical federalism.
But I can only see culture, language, and possibly communications. I don't see us going much beyond that by way of constitutional transfer.
That's quite a bit.
Administratively, yes, I think a great deal can be done. But if we're talking about constitution, I think we're into trouble with the rest of Canada.
Well, I agree with you. I'm a great believer in asymmetrical federalism. We've always had it, and it works. And most of the other countries have it as well. Federalist countries have it as well. But that you try to sell that one in the street, that guy's got something.
No, I don't.
Even though we have it. It's so hard to make these points.
What do you mean, even though we have it? Because
we have asymmetrical federalism right now. We always have it. Quebec's had special powers since 1774 in recognition of their language. They have. Newfoundland has a different constitutionally has a different school system than all the rest of the country, right?
Right.
I mean,
BC was guaranteed a railway.
Of course,
Prince Edward Island's guaranteed four seats in the House of Commons. Right. The only province in Canada today that's operating that guarantee.
Out of this mess, I mean, we have to try to find something positive. It seems to me, where I am. Despair. I do not believe that you're going to get politicians at the constitutional table in our lifetime. And if they did, they would, by convention, have to have a referendum. I think the mood is so bad. So you have to look at other alternatives. Administrative solutions, delegations under Section, 46. You have to look at political solutions. And at the end of the day, find ideas, the idea of a Canada, which is bigger than the idea of a separate Quebec. I mean, it's a big idea driving out a small idea. And to me, that's where the only opportunity lies, in persuading basically Quebecers who will make the decision that they're better off being part
that's
of a bigger unit.
That's where the symbolism comes in again, because that's where the dilemma comes in. You're right, I think that's the only opportunity we have is to do it that way. Like on the fisheries right now, there is devolution to Quebec that no other province has. Yeah. It's administrative.
Sure.
It's never been constitutionalized. And they do have more powers in the fishery than any other province. And it was done back in, I think, 1915, 1920, somewhere in that area. And they, you know, and it grew, and they have more powers over the fisheries, or exercise more powers by devolution. But I don't think, because I think you run right up against that wall again, and that wall is simply this, that Quebecers want to give them something by the side door in an administrative or political arrangement, no matter how well heralded in Quebec, is to me, is not on for Quebecers. They want to see this business of some direct constitutional thing and then being recognized.
Brian,
that
can
way.
I make an analogy? It's not a hell of a lot different than when the Saskatchewan wheat farmers are in trouble, as they were, and Grant used to go to the wall for them, and everybody in the country would go and say, let's help.
Yes.
And so we'd ship out $1 billion,
right.
at 50% of which came from Ontario. Nobody right. whined about it. It's part
and
of being a good neighbor
and
a friend. Or Newfoundland with
the
cod fishermen.
Exactly.
Ontario's paying a big percentage of it, and nobody's
that's
whining. That's part
different.
Of living in the same house.
Well, that's my whole point.
And let's,
Quebec won't accept
it
that way.
Goes back to Joe's point. Let's
that's
not
point.
Put everything as a matter
that's
of
that's why we don't have a constitution.
Or every marriage, if you every marriage and every relationship will fail if you try to count every single transaction and see who's the winner.
Exactly, but we would have a constitution if that was true. You see, but it's not true. We don't have a constitution, therefore it's not true.
The former Premier of Ontario is raising a good issue here, which I'm going to throw to him, which is Bob Rae is playing Ontario First right now. He is banging the drums very hard for Ontario First, and I'm not sure if the same situation had come up with Saskatchewan wheat, whether or not we'd seen the same response. You didn't do that. Look where you are today. Look where he is today. Is he more in tune with the public, with where the public is on this issue than where you were?
I can't judge that. But it goes back to a point I think that Howard, somebody made earlier. You know, when this discussion went on, everybody was on side.
and it was a nonpartisan. The big guys and the opposition were big. Bob Rae in opposition was a very supportive Canadian.
Very supportive.
Sensitive to the rest of the country, made passionate speeches for
the country. Didn't support you on Meech Lake.
Yes, he did. Absolutely.
When you gave up those six Senate seats, he was given interviews outside saying, I don't know about this.
The answer is he did support it, by the way.
He voted for it, but he sure didn't get...
Well, you know, he wanted to get a little attention.
He wasn't your pal like Mike Harris was at the time.
He wanted to get a little attention on that issue. No, but he supported it. And Meech Lake originally, and he did, he whined about it, but he supported it because he understood the consequence. He was there the whole time.
He encouraged it.
I invited him that whole week.
Didn't take your briefings all the time, right at the end, did he?
But Stephen, let me get into a serious point. you're trying to, I don't want to be mischievous here, but he has taken a totally different response now. So the question is, why? Has he changed his mind? Well, maybe he has, maybe he hasn't, because his philosophy is different. Or maybe he's responding to what he thinks the political mood is, or maybe it's born out of his own political desperation because he's got his own troubles and a number of things. The point is, the fact that he's doing it is very destructive for the country. And Quebec is very sensitive to the voices that come across. Are people sensitive to them outside of the country? Everything's a bloody fight with Quebec now, whether it's 30 jobs on an environmental thing.
Steve, I want to add to this.
Can I just say, we have a choice in this country. You can take every little incident and blow it into an insult in a grievous fight, or you can try to minimize it, try to work it out. I say respectfully, when we tried to work those stuff, and we're all different parties, we just have different points of view, but we tried to help each other. And didn't try to turn every chicken feed little issue into a partisan one.
The nub of Meech Lake to me in bringing it forward to right now is that we thought it would be less complicated if we fixed this constitutionally than let it go on and on and on. And what I think you're going to see now is that we will not be able to fix it, with due respect, Joe, in the Constitution, because the public won't understand it and won't support it. So I think that you're going to see at times a separatist government in Quebec. You may even see a referendum that supports sovereignty. But if you think the Constitution was complicated, wait till you start carving up the country with the institutions that are in Quebec, that are Canadian, and all of the complications financially, administrative, legally. You've got Air Canada, you've got Mother Bell, you've got big institutions,
you've got Seaways, you've got all kinds of things.
And when you get into that, it's going to be, as Brian said, just very complicated and very difficult. I think eventually, and I hope, Quebecers and the rest of the country are going to realize this is no easy task, splitting up this Siamese twin here, but it's going to be complicated and expensive
and hurtful to go through it,
and we didn't have to. And the final analysis, I would say, I'm optimistic in sort of a pessimistic sense that it will be so complicated and so difficult to split up this country in the final analysis. Expensive. That it'll probably not be done, but we'll pay the price. We will pay the price for standard living and economic principle
that at the end of the day, politicians will do the rational thing after they've exhausted all the other alternatives.
Well, there you are.
And maybe, because it doesn't make sense. But you know something? The breakup of Czechoslovakia made no sense. And you know what happened to Czechoslovakia? Some people use that as a model of how to break up a country. They do. But I could tell you the model, it's a model of what not to. It happened kind of by accident. They were going around pretending they were insulting each other. The guy said, Mečiar was running around in Slovakia saying, these guys have taken advantage all this time, we can do better. And these friends said, well, go. Okay, go. Shook hands. Nobody was killed. The economy's been depressed. Minorities are now, in both sides are now starting to get upset about the situation. And now the rational people are saying, let's put this sucker back together again. Mm-hmm. And we've got over this emotional burst, but these things, you can't put them back together. And Grant's right. It'll take 10 years of emotion and energy. Meanwhile, the interest rates will go up, the dollar will go lower, the standard of living will deteriorate, and we'll all say, why were we so stupid?
Okay. Yeah. Do you see any politician on the national scene today who's willing to risk, forgive me, his home base support in order to reach out to Quebec?
Well,
is there anybody?
In fairness, we talk about Meech Lake and about politicians coming together during the time of Meech Lake, but in 1992, I think, Joe, you were the only one around the table in Charlottetown, but it seems to me that those that followed us did attempt.
I think.
Again in 1992. That's only 2 years ago.
And they'll do it again in 1995 or 1996 if the circumstances warrant. Right now, it would be silly. to try to have a constitutional negotiation. There's a couple of political events that have to, that must happen in Canada first, namely a provincial election in Quebec, and secondly, a referendum in Quebec.
If the PQ wins.
If the PQ wins, yeah.
But Joe, regardless.
Yeah, perhaps we need a bigger catharsis. I mean, yeah. You know,
if the PQ don't win.
One at a time.
If the PQ don't win, people are going to say, oh, it's not a problem. If the PQ win, then people are going to get upset. Well, let them go play with
the Liberals. Well, let's hope that the Liberals under Johnston win.
Fair enough.
And then that will end the question, I would say, for 10, 15 years. We're right back.
Oh, 4 years. 4 years only.
Well, maybe yeah. You're talking the life of a government.
You're only deferring if Johnston wins.
It calms it down.
And Mr. Bouchard said that he'd have to pack up his tent in Ottawa and go home if they weren't successful, and he won't get the referendum. But I want to raise another point, Stephen, and I think it has to be addressed this evening. And David said that we probably will not have a further constitutional negotiation during our lifetime. And that's talking about the French-English question or the Quebec question, the rest of the country. But we absolutely have to have a constitutional negotiation, and a successful one at that, relating to justice for the Aboriginal peoples of Canada. I think that this issue is center in Canada today, and I think it's a shame
on Canada
that we're not dealing with that issue, and we must deal with it, and it has to be dealt with.
Everybody agrees with you, but do you think Quebec's going to come to a constitutional table when they're not? They don't. Joe,
no.
You're right. But it ain't going to happen.
Right, see,
if Johnston wins, he's talking status quo.
I'll bet you any amount of money that Daniel Johnston would not come to a constitution to discuss only Aboriginal rights.
I go back in that to the constitutional rounds between 82 and 87. Quebec didn't take its place at the table dealing with the Aboriginal negotiations at that time.
They were at the meetings we had.
All those options.
That's one of the unfortunate things that we didn't resolve the Meech Lake because the Aboriginal would have been dealt with, and I think would have been dealt with successfully.
But I like to dream. I like to dream a little bit too.
You're dreaming,
I do. But I think that it would send out a powerful signal to the world.
No question.
To the world, if we were able to address this question of justice for the Aboriginal people.
But you've got to convince enough people to go along with
it. Politicians may rise to that occasion. I mean, we have very serious problems in this country relating to the Aboriginal peoples of Canada, and I would think that given the right set of circumstances that we could deal with it, David, in the absence of dealing with the
Quebec
question.
You're arguing as Dean of Law at the Dalhousie, not as the former Premier of PEI.
Well, I have the benefit now of being a bit.
I agree. I'm acting as an analyst, but not as an advocate.
Steve,
I agree.
May I make one point?
It's the right and just thing to do. That's not the issue, Joe. The issue, are we really being realistic this is going to happen? And I think, Joe, you're dreaming a little bit right now. I'd love to dream, and we need big dreams. And I would support it absolutely, but I think, Joe, I think we're dealing with a whole different set of circumstances here.
History. We got to look at history, and perhaps, you know, as part of the Homo sapiens species, and you look at history, and there's some historians around who thematically will say that when you get societies in a large geographical mass like ours, having gone through what we've done and not yet reconciled it, that there has to be some greater cathartic event to occur in order to get us back on the right track, and therefore it may take, pessimistically speaking, looking at it more in a history kind of thing, that we're still in an irreconcilable kind of circumstance if you look at the various parts of the country, notwithstanding our own past and our desire to give away the petty things for the larger issue. I don't think Canada's there yet, and it may take, you know, more than a 72-cent dollar. It may take a 65-cent dollar and a few other, you know, more big things to occur negatively to bring us to our senses.
If the PQ wins the next election,
okay.
If they win the referendum, if the separatists win the referendum, what should English Canada do? Stand on the sidelines and wave them goodbye?
Can I comment on that? Look, I'll give you two examples. I recall so well, and Joe Giz was there, in 1990, I believe it was, when the Atlantic premiers and the New England governors met in Halifax. And to give you the thinking of the people of Nova Scotia generally, not all, but generally a consensus, the night that I introduced Robert Bourassa at the Sheraton Hotel in Halifax to a big audience, I introduced all the premiers and the governors, and they all got nice applause. When I introduced Robert Bourassa, I said, Robert Bourassa, the premier of Quebec, one of the main architects of the Meech Lake Accord to keep this country together. He got the longest and loudest standing ovation of anybody in that room that night, including myself. I got a standing ovation also.
He
got the longest and loudest.
He hastens to
add. Which is the most important point.
It was an indication to me.
That's a good story, John. Now, what's your next one?
My next point is this, that the people in Atlantic Canada generally, I think, understand what the consequences would be if your question, the question you're posing now, if all of this happens. And I understand what Grant is saying about the long period of time, but let's say that it did happen. The consequences to Atlantic Canada will be devastating, and the people understand that. Atlantic Canada would be hurt more by Quebec moving out of Confederation or out of this country than any other part of this Canada.
And therefore
Canada.
They would do what?
The people in that area, they want Quebec to remain as Canadians.
So what can they do?
I'll give you an example of that, what the consequences. I was interviewed by a Canadian press reporter, and he asked me, and Joel recall this because I called him right after it, I was asked, what will happen to Atlantic Canada if Quebec separates? And I said, look, there's only three alternatives if it happens. One, we remain as part of a fractured country with Quebec gone, which will be difficult. And I mentioned something about Ontario and that you may not want to support us anymore.
I'm fine.
Two, two, that we form our own country, the Atlantic provinces, which would be economically impossible, or that we join the United States.
Right.
And all of a sudden, before I knew what had happened, he left the office, and within 10 minutes, it was all over the country that I was proposing
that
the Atlantic Canadians become part of the United States. And I called Joe right away and told him what I had said to make sure that he understood how I had said it. I called Frank McKenna, I think, at the same time. But you see, the consequences to Atlantic Canada are very dire, no question about it. And I think that we've got to start thinking of what will happen to this country and what are the consequences if these things you just mentioned.
What about for Ontario, though? We're still going to trade with them. We're still going to visit them.
Everybody are severe. Believe me, Grant hit it on the point. We would spend 10 years unwinding the relationship. Then we would discover, and then I'll tell you what would happen. If Quebec goes, here's what will happen. Then you will start to see, you'll spend 10 years unwinding this. Every accountant, I mean, even the disagreements on the debt, the difference, the Boulanger Campo set the Quebec portion of the debt $80 billion. The CD House said $140 billion. How are you going to arbitrate that $60 billion difference? I just use that as an example, plus all the practical problems. Then what we would do is we would spend all this time unwinding. At the same time, you'd have political parties spring up across the country saying, let's join the United States here, let's form a new country. New political movements, they're all based on their own self-preservation. That would take a lot of energy. Then, after about 10 years, and we've got this whole thing unwound, our standard of living will have gone down, we will say, you know what? We share a continent with these guys, our neighbors. Since we have trade back and forth, what about mobility of labor? Then we'd start reconstructing superstructure to put it all back together.
Incredible.
And we would say, gee, it makes sense to get along with these guys. And Quebec would say it makes sense to get along with us. You see, this neo-nationalism that Quebec is part of today is not limited to Canada. It's all around the world today. We're living in some of the most difficult times in modern history. Somehow or other, we've got to persuade people that the idea that Canadian nationalism is more important than Quebec nationalism. And Canadian nationalism incorporates Quebec nationalism. To me, that's the challenge.
How do you do this,
and
David?
It's got something to do
how
with
do you do it?
Being kind to other people, loving each other. I mean, I don't want to be silly.
No,
sharing things.
Yep.
Being sensitive to other people, recognize their differences, respect their differences, go as far as you can. All the same kind of advice you say, you'd give your son about how do you get along in America.
Are those the wrong sentiments for the time?
Look, they're never wrong sentiments. Ever in history are they wrong sentiments. Sometimes they're not fashionable, but they're never wrong.
How do you get people to appreciate and understand the consequences of what would happen to this country in the event there's a referendum and it's yes, and they start the process.
You can't scare them into it.
You
can't
scare them into it. That's why I think you're going to have to go through some greater negative experience before.
Like you're going to have to declare war on the states? How about that?
Where the negative experience might be, if indeed, and there's different stages here. First, there is the election of a PQ government. Obviously, That should occur. We're still in it. We're trying to still sell the message of Canada. If there is a referendum and the sovereignty vote is achieved, then we're into the negotiations. I agree. I think the negotiations will be very difficult. We're going to be arguing with division of assets, deficit, all the rest. But out of that, we might very well reach a point where there's a recognition, both in Quebec and outside Quebec, this is too costly. The Parti Québécois at that point may be in political trouble, because you're looking at that stage about 3 or 4 years down the line.
Howard, I only
Then there might be that opening, yeah. But well, there wouldn't be an opening before then.
There may be an opening before then, because if you, I don't know if you read the article in the Globe and Mail today by a political scientist who talks about the platform that the Parti Québécois has passed
at their convention, which says...
Yeah, this election, if they win this election, they believe that they have a mandate to move towards separation immediately. And when the referendum comes 2 years from now, it'll only be to support the mechanics.
Okay, gentlemen,
idea of the referendum.
We literally have just a few minutes left tonight. Let me ask you in the remaining few moments that we have to give your successors some advice. What should they be doing now or in the year ahead as we move up to that Quebec election and that potential referendum? What should they, what can they do to prevent the country from falling apart, if that is, in fact, what they want to see happen? Joe Gibbs.
Stop this talk that's going on today that we're hearing from Ontario with Premier Ray with these 30 jobs in Montreal. Stop this divisive talk about adding up everything that goes to Quebec. Every time something goes to Quebec, it's front page news. If it goes to one of the other provinces, it's not such a big deal. I think that we have to have generosity. We have to reach out. We have to understand how Quebecers feel about the situation. They felt, unlike people outside of Quebec, that the rejection of Meech was a rejection of Quebecers. I think David said this earlier. We have to reach out with magnanimity to the people of Quebec and tell them we love them and we want them to stay in this country and provide some tangible evidence of that.
Give Roy Romano some advice. I know you do it all the time.
I think that and believe that leaders are going to have to be prepared to set the example. And I honestly think that people around the Meech Lake table set the example, because there were some serious sacrifices made. And that's not easy for politicians to do. And some were tempted at Meech Lake not to do that. And the consequences were dramatic. But if you want my advice to the leadership of today, you have to be prepared to put a lot on the line for the country. And if they're prepared to do that, then you've got a chance before you get into the real mess that's coming down the
Running
road.
Running out of time. 30 seconds, Premier Peckford.
Do it in less than 30. We have to get our financial house in order, because that gives better stability and makes people feel good. So a financial and economic house in order, a lot better than we're doing at the present time. On the economic financial side, on the political side, there has to be due process on almost any decision which affects any part of Canada, which is extremely transparent and which involves the people more than it has in the past.
Howard
then
Paul.
We might have a chance.
Two items. First, we had to think in terms of as Canadians rather than of our own particular parochial self-interest or provincial interest. Due process is another one which I think is an area that requires a lot further examination. We have to be much more sensitive to that process in the future.
John Buchanan.
I agree with what Joe Giz said, and what Grant Devine said, and what Brian said, and Howard. But seriously, I think people have got to understand, appreciate what can happen in this country if a lot of those things happen in Quebec. I think we've got to be generous, we've got to be charitable, we've got to understand that this is a country from coast to coast, from one coast to the other, including the north, and we've got to embrace Quebec, and we've got to do it in very simple terms as far as constitution is concerned.
David Peterson, take the last 45 seconds.
I agree with my colleagues, and I think Joe put it particularly passionately. If we can't rediscover some passion and some bigness and some size of heart in this country, it's not going to be saved. And it's got to come from
the leaders.
The top, it's got to come from the top. It's got to. This is not a logical fight we're in. It's a fight about emotions. Nationalism is not a rational kind of a discussion. We have to capture people's vision. We have to put forward a new vision. We have to put forward a generous one, and we have to do it with eloquence and commitment. And if we don't, it's going to be every man for themselves, every region for themselves, every person for themselves, pandering to the lowest common denominator, not the highest values we can engender, and then that happens, it's finished.
Gentlemen, thank you so much for coming here tonight. We appreciate your time. David Peterson, John Buchanan, Howard Pauley, Joe Giz, Grant Devine, Brian Peckford. We appreciate it.
Help TVO create a better world through the power of learning. Visit supporttvo.org and make a tax-deductible donation today.